Hey, I'm Andy. If you don't know me, it's probably because I'm not famous. But I did start a men's grooming company called Harry's. The idea for Harry's came out of a frustrating experience I had buying razor blades. Most brands were overpriced, overdesigned, and out of touch. At Harry's, our approach is simple. Here's our secret. We make sharp, durable blades and sell them at honest prices for as low as $2 each. We care about quality so much that we do some crazy things, like buy a world-class German blade factory. Obsessing over every detail means we're confident in offering a 100% quality guarantee. Millions of guys have already made the switch to Harry's, so thank you if you're one of them. And if you're not, we hope you give us a try with this special offer. Get a Harry starter set with a 5-blade razor, weighted handle, shave gel, and a travel cover, all for just $3 plus free shipping. Just go to harrys.com and enter 5000 at checkout. That's harrys.com, code 5000. Enjoy.
You chose Triple H because I took the one thing from you that was most important. Your career.
Is that what you think? I have stayed away and stayed true to my retirement because I am a man of my word. Because I am a man of honor, a man of integrity. I have stayed away and stayed retired out of respect for the system, out of respect for them, and most importantly, I've stayed retired out of respect for you. Out of respect. Respect for The Undertaker.
Is it respect? Or is it fear?
What's going on, everybody, and welcome back to the A Show. I am your host, Justin Davis, and I have my co-host here, Meelz. What's going on, Meelz? How you doing?
I am not Bill, but I am Meelz.
Yes, you are back. Meelz, you got your job taken last week.
You know what? A lot of people liked it, and I don't know how I feel about that.
Yeah, a lot of people were like, you know what? His takes were less problematic. He likes women.
Listen, I don't know how I completely felt about that. So you know what? But you know what? You're stuck with me. Fuck it. You're stuck with me.
Oh, wow.
For at least the next couple of months as we are on the road to the 50th episode of the A Show.
A Show 50. And we have so many things that we are planning out for A Show 50. We just talked about it off air. But there's going to be a lot of opportunities for the fans of the show to get interactive with us. And we're going to be rolling out those ideas within the next 4 weeks because it's that time.
It's that time.
I want to thank Bill Hanstock last week at Sundown Motel for joining the show. A rare guest that we have on this show. One of my favorite guests, you know?
Yeah. And then you also were on AfterBuzz TV. So look at you, man.
Yeah, I was on AfterBuzz TV, gave a big shout out to RNC. So hopefully a lot of people that listen to that or watch that, you can watch that on AfterBuzz TV YouTube page and actually listen to it on their podcast. I believe they're on iTunes and SoundCloud. But I hope a lot of people that listen to me and saw me last week talk about Velveteen Dream's shawl/suspenders.
Of course.
We'll show up this week and listen to the A Show. So shout out to Bill. We also have another co-host here today. You heard him just now. Migo the dog.
Migo the dog. Listen, I'm happy. Listen, I wish I had a fellow co-host of my own.
What? Well, you know what? You can get one, because all he's going to do is just lay on you like this. What do you want? You're already... Of course you have to cough. He's just looking at me like, what? What? But yes, we have a very stacked episode for you this week on RNC Radio, on the A Show, rather. Let's get into it. No holds barred. This weekend, or this past weekend, we finally saw the culmination of months of speculation, rather, and a lot of talk, really. We saw the culmination of All In Weekend that coincided with StarCast last weekend in Chicago. Meelz, were you abreast of any of the festivities? I know you kind of keep out of things, but did you watch All In? Did you see anything that was going on? What did you feel about it?
I watched All In. I watched All In.
Wow.
I watched it all. I watched all of it. I watched All In. And I'm sure people assumed that I wasn't going to watch it. I fucking watched it. I found some time on Sunday. I said, you know what? Let me curl up with a good All In. Oh, shit. This shit is 4 hours. I'm going to have to scroll through a couple matches. Listen, 4 hours is... Listen, there's only one promotion I'll dedicate 4 hours to, and I only do that once per month. So
turn that up.
But I did watch I'd say about 85% of All In. I was okay. All In.
So did you watch the three-man events, basically?
I did watch the three-man events. We were talking about Marty Scurll versus Okada.
Yeah.
We were talking about Cody Rhodes versus what's-his-face?
Nick Aldis, Gunner.
Nick Aldis, TNA. There we go. And then we are also talking about the six-man tag between the Bucks and Kota Ibushi versus Rey Mysterio and
Bandito and Phoenix.
There you go. All right.
There you go. I knew it was about to get slippery.
Just rolled right off the tongue. But this is that podcast synergy. You just pick up where I fucking dropped the ball. But I did watch all of it. I thought it, you know what? Overall, I thought it was an entertaining show. It had
best show of the year. Best show of the year is what I'm hearing.
No. It's just no. But it had a completely significant moment with, you know, Cody winning the NWA championship, similar to that of his father, continuing the legacy and really having earned it at this point of his time in his career. And I think if you remember All In for anything, and which is a great idea, quite honestly, with the booking of that thing, because usually if Cody Rhodes didn't win, I don't know if this, you know, All In would have been as memorable or made as many headlines or had been just be able to recall anything within the next 3 months. But you know that, you know, Cody Rhodes won the NWA championship. So there's at least that.
Yeah, and I mean, the match was whatever. I think the match didn't
It was
matter.
A huge whatever. It was big yeah. whatever.
It was yeah. a lot of overbooking bullshit in it.
That elbow drop to Brandy, man. Come on. Yeah. They're building drama. They're building high drama. As sure. Michael Cole would call it.
I thought that All In was a bit of a mixed bag. It delivered on some things. And didn't deliver on a lot of other things. I think people are giving it... I feel like people are really grading it on a curve. Mm. I think kind of like the big matches that people were really looking forward to, like Kenny versus Penta. I mean, they didn't have story to it, so it was just kind of like an exhibition match. So you're automatically kind of taken out of it right there. It feels like a PWG match, essentially, where it's like you just kind of throw the match out there. But yeah. it didn't really grab you until like the last 5 minutes. And then
I agree.
And then you had stuff like the Chicago street fight with Janela and Adam Page, which was great. But then they turn around and they had like penis druids show up and
well, guess Joy what? Ryan. I didn't see that match, so that was one of the matches I skipped. And
but you're familiar with the penis druids thing.
Of course. The penis druids for me are new, but the entire penis gimmick in itself, yes, I am very much aware. But the penis druids, that's a new thing that I'm not, you know, I don't know if wrestling, professional wrestling is completely ready for that. Then the fans of All In apparently were, so I don't know, you know.
They loved it, and they thought it was awesome. And I was like, if this had happened on any other thing, and I think people are kind of covering it up with, this is an alternative.
If this happened on Impact, it would have been a completely different story.
Oh yeah, it would have been. I mean, they killed the kid on Impact, and people wanted their heads, you know. And we talked about that last. We talked about that a week ago or 2 weeks ago. Like it, yeah. It was a problem for them, and I just feel like All In was. It's a 6.5 show to me. I feel like that was a show that you would have had to have been there and been invested. And right. my investment to the Bullet Club and the Elite has been, I mean, noticeably absent for the past year and a half. I haven't really liked them that much.
I felt like the people in the general arena had fun, which is like, okay. I mean, at no point during the show, I felt like they were sitting on their hands with anything. But maybe during the fatal four-way women's match. But I felt just in general, it was an entertaining show for everyone who was invested in it. Me watching the day after, I thought, you know, it was cool. I'm scrolling through a couple things. I thought the Okada Marty Scurll match was very good.
Very long match.
Apparently went over by 12 minutes, which is like, to me, it's like, how does that happen?
To me, I mean, we could just get right into it. To me, how do you not time out your show? Because like Marty Scurll has gone on Sean Mooney's show and said that it wasn't him who had to go over time. It was another match that went over.
Oh. You
so sure? My thing is, that's what that's what Marty says. And my sure, thing is,
because he got the longest match. It's not like there was another, like a couple of these matches aren't touching like 12 minutes.
12 minutes, yeah. And
Unless the penis thing went a little bit long, you know.
I mean, honestly, that might have been too long. And maybe the coronation, like Cody was always going to get 20 minutes for that coronation and that match.
Of course.
The women's match was going to get time because it was the only women's match on the show.
Of course.
The Janela match might have gone over. I feel as though that match didn't need to be that long. But if it
went over some time, it would have, you know what? It is what it is.
And Kenny got like 20 minutes. So it's like. The number one thing you do when you do these types of shows is like you time them out. I'm not going to say I'm a master of it, but I mean, I do know that's like the number one thing. Like there's people that do this for 52 weeks out of the year and they know how to time out a show. So you got a main event where, you know, it's the Young Bucks. It's supposed to be like a huge athletic contest. It went 10 minutes and then the show ended right after they got the pinfall hit. And you're just left with a feeling of like, okay, this is, to me, you know, watching it, it was like, this is a big event. It just ended out of nowhere.
Yeah, the mad rush to the end was pretty hilarious to me. I'll be quite honest with you.
Oh, you could hear the ref loudly say, go home, go home, go home.
And I think they went on for like 4 minutes after that. Like they essentially really like took it to the absolute last point that they could have taken it to.
They said they had like 1 second to spare, I believe they said.
Oh, it had to be. The man was screaming as they were fading out into the logo. but it's a, you know, it, just things happen. I think this is a learning experience in the first year.
You think they're going to have another one of these?
I think they
are. Like granted, if the Bucks leave even?
You know, I think... If Cody and the Bucks continue to stay on the independent scene, do I think next year they could have one? 100%. But if they leave, I don't know who else is throwing this thing.
Marty Scurll, All In Part 2. He'll have to be the hottest.
I feel like he, if anyone's like, get me my, you know, developmental deal, it's Marty Scurll. That's how I feel. I feel like, yo, if there's anyone who's just like, man, I got logos ready. I got an umbrella for every fucking... you know, take over event. Let's do this. I feel like he's the one who could essentially probably make a halfway decent name in the NXT developmental territory. Listen, quite honestly,
he's going straight to 205 Live.
Immediately
to 205 Live. But I mean, the show notwithstanding,
or NXT UK or something. I don't know.
Yeah, that he worked there for sure. On the show notwithstanding, how did you feel about what you saw of StarCast? You saw Tony Schiavone. I'm pretty sure you saw the picture of Tony Schiavone getting a lap dance.
So that's really the only thing I saw, and that's all I needed to see at that point. to me, you know, I'm not – in terms of actual – you know what? I think you have better opinions on StarCast. I did not keep up with the StarCast thing. We weren't there. Not that we needed to be there, but I didn't really feel a sense of like – tune into it or I should be invested in it. So I just opted not to. But what do you think?
It was what I said it was going to be. And they said it was, you know, super inclusive, all this shit. And it ended up being white dudes with beards and black t-shirts. And
that's what I thought. That's essentially, it's just like, I feel like it was a bunch of white dudes getting whatever, you know, just doing their thing, you know, in professional wrestling terms, and just having these really wacky, quirky inside jokes that aren't that funny and all these other things. Yeah. I'm sure
it was very white.
That's what I say. If I was a person of color, I may not have, you know, had to share the same experience. But it's problematic
all around. I mean, because if you're not going to invite,
Migo believes so.
Yeah, Migo just barked at it. He was fed up. He's barking at a ball that he's playing with, and I'm like, the ball is not going to bark back at you, Migo. What are you doing? But I feel like if this was a situation where they did invite like people at Russell Rap and shit like that, like this would have been a cool idea. But it ended up looking silly in the end. Like the panels ended up looking like complete under attended garbage. And I think that next year they need to get more people, like more women, more Asian women, Hispanic women, African-American women, and men, and podcasts, and get them to talk about certain stuff. Like, I think that is still something that they have overlooked this year and they can do better on. And I think that from what we saw this year, they didn't do a great job on it.
I think they can do better, but the question is, can they actually do better? The question to me is, is that even on their radar to the point of doing better? Or is it really just sort of a club where it's just like, okay, we have, you know, the Bruce Pritchards and the Tony Schiavones and that sort of, you know, corner of the wrestling world, as opposed to the new breaking sort of voices and journalism and things like that, and highlighting those? Does it really just become, okay, we're going to bring Kevin Nash, you know, not to say that he's there, but just an example, we're going to have Kevin Nash there and we're going to have him talk for 60 minutes about the NWO for maybe the 26th time? Or are we going to have, like, you know, fresh new faces bringing their own perspective, bringing their own flavor, bringing brand new ideas and sort of do that? I don't know if they have the capacity enough to actually, you know, think that. I don't know if they actually have that sort of, you know, being able to, you know, see talent and see new talent and see what they can sort of bring. I think they're fine with what they've got over there, and they're going to
the good old boys,
essentially, with what they got over there. And maybe you bring in a Peter Rosenberg or something to just, you know, okay, you know, this is, but he's not going to show up to the event, as he said on Twitter. But maybe you have one of those, but essentially, yeah, it's a good old boys club. So maybe we, you know, we come up with our own thing and do our own thing at some point.
I'm with it. If y'all are with it, let us know. Hit us up.
Let us know.
At OGJohnny5, at Meelz TV. Let's crash StarCast. Let's think about that. Let's do I'm trying to think of a name. Like,
just set some shit up outside, right? Just set some shit up outside and just do
let's do what they did. You know what I'm saying? Let's do what they did.
Bring a tank or something and just, you know,
hostile takeover. You know what I'm saying? We could bring Popeyes and all that shit. You know? Let's crash the cast. Let's crash the cast next year. But that's all I had to say about that. Moving on to another legendary thing. Batista is a legendary bag fumbler. Okay. Just this week, he went on an interview and said that he's unsure on if he will return to play Drax on the latest Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 movie, which has been indefinitely delayed since the firing of the director, James Gunn. He said he's not sure if he wants to work for Disney anymore, and he is actually kind of moonlighting to return to the WWE. Bad idea, I think. I think that's a terrible idea, and I think Batista is going to go down in history as probably one of the stupidest motherfuckers on Earth for actually, if this actually goes through and they actually fire him.
I need to look at Dave Batista's IMDb because
it is terrible.
It is. There's no way, if he did not get this film, he would not already be back in the WWE. Yeah. But, well, let's see. It looks like he has signed. It says he signed with CAA. What is that?
Yeah, he just signed with CAA, Creative Artist Agency. He just changed talent agency. So that's what a lot of people are thinking, that is a major reason why he might be leaving Guardians, because he's going to have to get some things lined up, because that was going to be his year next year.
I don't think any year was going to be his year. But
I mean, you know, that was going to be, he was going to be filming it and stuff. That's
oh, gotcha. Yeah. But Batista, man, I feel like Batista for the last, and not to say that he's a bad guy. I don't share any dislike for Batista, but I do not share his opinion on this entire thing or how he's going about it. I think for a large number of years, he's been someone who always just liked to sort of do his own thing. He left WWE on his own terms. He, you know, tried to fight Booker T on his own terms. And look at how that turned out. he's done a lot of things on his own terms. And I don't know if this is really the hill you want to die on or just the
over tweets.
Over tweets. I don't know if this is the right decision, but this is I'll say it's very in line. It's noble to a fault. I'll say that.
Like I get you riding for your mans.
Right. 100%.
Like Meelz, if you said some crazy shit, I'm gonna be like, yo, that was some crazy shit that you said back in the day. I'm not rocking with it. But I'm not, you would understand if I said I'm not fucking up my back for it. Chris Pratt is not, other than that weird little thing they did last month with the, that little take a stand thing that didn't work at all. And Disney still fired the guy. Like, other than that, Chris Pratt, Zoe Saldana, all the rest of the cast members, they're like, yeah, we're not going to say anything else about it. We want the money. Like, I get it, Batista. Take the, you know, take a stand, but take a stand after the bag has been, like, I don't know, man. I just feel like there's certain things you ride for. And I could see if this was like a big, maybe racial inequality, maybe stand up for that, you know, like maybe that's a bigger issue than a 47-year-old talking about pedophilia. I don't know.
I think so. I'll be honestly, it's kind of, you know what, Batista, you know,
would you want him to come back
to the WWE?
I don't think there's a role for him.
I think they'd find a role for him, but it's just like, it's going to be hard to acclimate to the entire thing. They're going to want to bring him in as a face again. He's going to want to be a heel. I don't think he's going to do the full time dates. I think he's going to try to go for the Lesnar-esque bag. Just because of, I guess, his notoriety outside of the WWE and just not being able to, I can see it happening in the future. I can see them definitely saying, oh, we want to like, maybe let's go with Roman versus Batista because we were trying to do that 1 year and it never happened. I could see definitely that going on. But do I see him as a permanent fixture in WWE? No, he's like fucking 40. He's like 40, 50 years old.
Yeah, he's like 45. He was looking old. I was watching Blade Runner.
There's no way he's 45. Let me see.
I think he's like 45, bro.
He's 49.
49? Damn. Ain't no way he's not doing a Batista bomb no more, bro.
Nah, like, you know why I know he wasn't 45? Because when I found out he was 35, I was like, what? Like, remember in like 2003, everyone found out Batista was like almost 40. And like everyone was just shocked. He was like, man, he's here like hovering around 40. And I'm just like, God damn. But you know, I could see him.
Hey, listen, don't say that when I'm 35, okay?
No, I'm not going to say that. Everyone knows you're going to be 35, man. Come on.
I'm just saying. Don't like have that reaction when I turn 35.
Listen, when we're in our 30s, 30s is going to be fucking awesome. I mean, you're in your 30s. I will get there one day.
Let's move off the age. Let's move to the next point of No Holds Barred. WWE and Hideo Itami made a visit to Pro Wrestling Noah last weekend. They allowed and a talent, kind of like a talent exchange. There was no exchange yet, but they let Hideo Itami go back to Noah, just originally where he was stationed before he got picked up by the WWE, to face Naomichi Marufuji and for his 20th anniversary show in a really, really solid match that I really liked. If you have a chance to find a way to go watch that, I'm pretty sure you people know the way. I really liked the match. It was good. I think it was cool for two dudes that are kind of circling 40. I believe Marufuji might be 40. I don't have his age right in front of me, but I know Hideo is nearing 40. But for two dudes that aren't really where they used to be yet, I thought that they attempted to do the best kind of pastiche of a match that they probably had a decade ago, or maybe 15 years ago. And I thought it came off really well. They were kicking the absolute shit out of each other. And I know Itami, he looked happy to be there, honestly. He was able to play his old character. And I thought that the crowd really loved him being there. And it was really cool of WWE to actually allow this to happen. They don't do this often. They do it often now, but they don't do something like to this, you know, to this stage very, very often.
I like it. I feel like we need it more in professional wrestling. It keeps the business healthy and it keeps it thriving, quite honestly. And moves like this from the WWE's part in the talent exchange. And we see, like, later this month, they're going to allow Velveteen Dream to go back to his old fed and, you know, and face, you know, face somebody. I forgot who it is. Is he? Oh, my God.
Darby Allin. He's facing one night and he is facing. Who's the last guy? I forgot the last guy. I know Darby Allin's one of them. Darby Allin's one of them.
Me, it continues to help the business thrive and it continues to shed light on different promotions and just different talent, quite honestly, and it helps them sort of come up and they have their moments. So I'm completely with it. 100%.
Yeah, absolutely. I
not to say really that Noah needs it, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. But like
Noah, it's not New Japan, but Noah has their own following, and I think Noah has their own like kind of like aces that they've kind of started to develop over the past couple years.
Right.
I think that they should definitely get some of those young guys and bring them over and have like a one-off with NXT, or you know, kind of just do an excursion. I would love for NXT to be a place where people can go to do excursions like they do with CMLL and stuff like that. Like that's the next logical step of everything, as far as you know. What Triple H foresees the future of the business being, but yeah, I thought it was a great match. I think if they can exchange one of their own talents from Noah to WWE, that would be definitely an awesome thing to see. And it would introduce people like you to Noah.
I feel like, quite honestly, even before we get a talent, before we ever get a talent exchange between Noah and WWE, we're probably gonna get like NXT Japan. Like other part.
I mean, that's coming. That's coming. Is there any question that the NXT Japan is coming?
No, it's without a shadow of a doubt. I feel like it's a market still untapped, and maybe they want to go for it.
Yeah, for sure. Last thing on No Holds Barred. The Mae Young Classic 2 starts tonight. It will have started when this episode airs. Are you excited for the Mae Young Classic 2? Have you read the spoilers? I don't know if you even read the spoilers.
So I found out who's in the finals. So I kind of know how it shakes down after a while.
Yeah, but I mean, you know.
But it's always entertaining. I don't know the matchups, but it's always entertaining to see the matchups in itself. Like, I'm not going to, you know, reading the spoilers is one thing where you know the results of what happens. But the journey to actually get there is a completely different other thing. That's an experience in its own right of, like, entertainment and physicality. Just, you know, it brings you a mutual respect for the women involved in this entire thing. So, to the set, I have read a couple of spoilers. Really, just the ending. Just, like, who's going to be in the finals. But, you know, other than that, I guess...
I think it's gonna be a great tournament. The matchups in the next couple of weeks that are actually starting off are gonna be absolutely like kind of crazy. I won't spoil it, but it's definitely check it out. We'll definitely be watching it and reviewing it. That'll be another show that we add, as well as Mixed Match Challenge is coming back. Are you ready?
Mixed Match, baby! It's back after a 6-month hiatus.
Well, that's how seasons work. So I mean, this is going to be season 2. They've had a summer off, bringing back in the fall.
Here's what I say for this season 2. I feel like maybe in season 3 they'll decide to shake things up, but literally the exact same thing so soon, I don't think it's going to work the same thing as season
1. Well, you want
season 1 didn't work that great, to be honest with you.
But the thing is, people are looking at the viewership as if that was the only confirmation that it was a success. And I think on Facebook side, it got people to watch Facebook watch at times where no one was watching Facebook watch.
Yeah.
So that's why it was a success to them. And if they can get that again, and I think they have the matchups to do it. I think you bring back your most popular matchups. I think Miz, Asuka, they garnered some of the highest views, I want to say.
Interesting considering they're both on different rosters now.
Yeah. Well, no, they're on the same brand now.
Asuka's on SmackDown. Oh, Asuka is on SmackDown. Yeah. Oh my God! And we got to talk about her too.
We're gonna talk about her today. Yeah.
Oh so, my I mean, God! They're on the
same. They're on the same brand. They're on the same side this year, and they've broken it up into the Raw side and the SmackDown side, I believe.
Okay. All right.
Well, so yeah, it's cool. I mean, you know, the team everyone's gonna watch out for is Carmella and R-Truth. I think that's the moment he pins her. That's gonna be like everyone's gonna pop.
the decarmelization has started on this episode of SmackDown, which we will get into.
Yes.
But
I knew you were ready for it. But yeah,
I was ready. We'll talk about it.
Yeah, Mixed Match Challenge 2 is coming September 18th, I want to say. It's in 2 weeks.
It's coming on September 18th. Yes.
September 18th. Which means
late night 205s again, which means
yep.
Which means fucking guys changing the ropes 3 times in one night, which means you staying at your tape shows longer than you thought you were. Which means, you know, good old-fashioned tournament. This is fun. This is literally fun stuff. To me, I think they need to shake it up for season 3 if we get to season 3. I think they can't keep the same format. I think just like a reality show, they need to sort of change it up and add a different twist to it. And I think they actually need to do that with season 2, quite honestly, if they want people to tune in.
Well, we'll see what they do with season 2. But, we have 2 more wrestling shows during the week to watch starting this week, so I just want you to get ready for the amount of things we're going to be reviewing.
Boom.
There you go. But let's get into our show reviews. Let's start with Monday Night Raw, which to me was... Raw has reset itself unto itself 3 times since SummerSlam. Have you noticed this?
I feel like... How do I feel?
Because the first big reset was the Shield coming back and Braun turning. The next big reset was kind of like the Bella stuff coming into it. And now the next big reset is the tag championships.
I feel like I don't know if it's much of a reset as to they're finally doing interesting things on Monday Night Raw.
And people looked at this show as a terrible show, and I thought it was I thought it flew by to me.
If I was in the crowd in Columbus, Ohio, and
they popped for everything, Meelz. They popped for everything on Monday.
If I got to see The Shield, if I got to see Kevin Owens return after, I quit, surprise return, if I got to see The Undertaker and Shawn Michaels, if I got to see a championship change hands, I would be like, that's a fucking amazing show.
Yeah, I thought it was to me, the 3 hours flew by. I know the in-ring wasn't as strong as usual weeks of Raw, but the storytelling to me was on point. I think
it superseded that, in my opinion.
And if you're going to keep it 100, I really, and I've said this before, I love the addition of Baron Corbin as the Constable. I think he is a different type of snarky, smarmy heel than has been played by Brad Maddox, because he can actually get into the ring and he actually puts himself in it. I think the way that he delivers these promos, even though they sound so like delivered off of a script for him, they're hilarious the way he delivers them.
I think just in general, the flavor, because we've had essentially been the authority for on and off for the last 4 years or so. And then we've had like Mick Foley and Kurt Angle. This is just a breath of fresh air in terms of just like, okay, now we can play with the direction of things. And I think we're finding out that maybe a heel authority figure is maybe the way to go on Monday Night Raw.
Right.
So it opposes SmackDown a little bit more and things get a little bit more interesting in how the faces come back from things, as opposed to Kurt Angle kind of like his brain sort of stroking out and making matches and forgetting he's making them or something like that. But, I think this brings an interesting thing, especially when Kurt Angle comes back and they're sort of, I feel like they're going to make them play with one another and they're both going to be general manager of Raw at some point. But it's a good season for Monday Night Raw thus far.
Yeah, it's been a pretty good season. I think, the major thing that happened, and they did it at the top of the show, which I thought was very, very smart. They had the Bellas return against the Riot Squad. Sans Ruby, who sat out for this one, it was Sarah Logan and Liv Morgan. And they very, it was fine. But I think that, everyone's going to talk about the Brie botches, which I know you felt very, you were very concerned about Brie.
So here's the thing. All right, she has ring rust. I get that 100%.
So let's preface that with she hasn't been in the ring.
She has not been in the ring consistently for. She was in the ring like over the weekend on like house shows facing the Riot Squad because they got to run through this match before they actually do it. Because once again, ring rust. You haven't been in the ring for quite a long time. The dives, man.
Two of them.
Those dives were scary. And the second one,
the first one was like she just got tripped up.
Yeah, because everyone was saying, like, what's her face? It was Sarah Logan's fault. I was like, it was kind of Sarah Logan's fault, but it was also Bree's fault a lot. And then the second one, I was just like, all right, so you just didn't learn your lesson the first time because you really thought, like, Daniel Bryan has to bounce off the ropes to sail out the ring. What makes you think you can just dive, like, start halfway in the ring and dive out of the ring and just
fly? I think they had practice this spot, and she knew she was going to do it. And you know, with wrestling, they just restart. They'll just redo it, just redo the spot, and reset everything.
Listen, nothing is wrong with a nice, respectable baseball slide. You know what I'm saying? Right. It's just like a nice little kick to the back. Maybe you don't get completely out or something like that. But nothing's wrong with it. But the dive thing, man, you ate shit on that dive.
Yeah, she looked like you seen that meme of Ralph Wiggum just falling through the window? That's what it looked like. And
she got up like, no, I'm okay, I'm tired, I'm fine, I'm great, I'm great.
Hey, she got up and finished the match, and I thought it was an okay match. I'm very, very impressed by Liv Morgan as of late. I think she's gone up and somehow Sarah Logan's gone down. It's like they're kind of like trading off on who's doing the worst job. But Liv Morgan, she's really a bright spot. She's really been growing to me.
Liv Morgan, I think it's because she's been getting so many reps in the ring. I mean, if there's anyone that's consistently been on Raw and then pretty much everyone is consistent on Raw unless you're like Mojo Rawley or something. But she's been getting consistent reps in the ring, and it's really showing and it's really improving. I'm really all in for it, quite honestly.
And speaking of another reset and reboot, how do we forget this one? Authors of Pain have gotten a refresh. The new manager is bewildering. And you know what? I like this, but like they're, you know, you're watching Raw and, you know, next thing they, you know, they do the coming up next. You're walking to the, you know, the shows the wrestlers walking to the ring. It's Drake Maverick clad in AOP gear. And this is 205 Live general manager Drake Maverick, which is like, we're breaking all types of rules if we are breaking any rules at this point. Drake Maverick, he is now the manager for the Authors of Pain, taking Paul Ellering's spot and honestly giving these guys another opportunity to kind of get that magic they had in NXT. And I mean, I'm not mad at it. I know a lot of people were like kind of confused, but I mean, I love that WWE just said, fuck it, let's just do it, and didn't explain any of it.
You know, I thought that was also very refreshing in terms of them taking that sort of stance and be like, all right, let's just do it. It just makes sense. It's like, it's not like we don't have to come up with this long, elaborate story for this one thing.
Because there is none. There isn't a story there.
It's just a guy just said, you know what? I like you guys. I want to join you guys. And sometimes it's just really how life happens. But him dressing up in the oversized gear is just like, all right.
I think he should have wore a suit. I don't think that gear is right for him. I think that's my only issue with that. With that new alignment is that he should not wear the gear. He should just wear his 205 Live suits. I think that'd be a better, more Paul Heyman, if you will, ish move to do. They did win a squash match, and I think we're off to the races as far as the rebrand for Authors of Pain within the 5 months. A lot of people said that, or have been saying that they've been wasted on the main roster and et cetera, et cetera. And listen, there's a lot of extenuating circumstances that happen between these two guys that were just more than just like travel issues. Like, injuries that have been going on with them since they've even been called up. And I think people are forgetting that, like, when they got injured or they had that visa problem the first time, WWE had to move on. And that's just really what happens. It's next man up. And I think that this is the opportunity for them to have some bangers, which with the Revival, who I mean, after what happened tonight, will probably turn face.
Yeah, that would be weird, wouldn't it?
I mean, they kind of have to if you really want to get. I mean, if you see what happened, but we'll get to that in a second. Before we get to that, Shawn Michaels made an appearance on the show this Monday to talk about last time ever. You know, that statement they love to say on pro wrestling. Cut a really good promo with the Dead Man Undertaker, who came back, but this didn't feel like a promo to promote the Triple H Undertaker match. This felt like a promo to set up a program between Shawn Michaels and the Undertaker 8 years later.
You know, this was very similar to the last sort of interaction they had in the ring face to face, which was right before, you know, the last, you know, time at the end of an era match that we had at WrestleMania 28, where, you know, Undertaker talked about retiring Shawn and that he didn't have it, and this was in a sort of similar vein. Well, first of all, I like Shawn Michaels came out, even though he's like 8 years late on the shilling your merchandise thing. You just just wear the merchandise and it sells itself. Undertaker coming out was a surprise, which I loved because no one expected him to be there, to my knowledge.
Well, I mean, people have seen him, but you were a good guy. You didn't read any of the dirt sheets.
Oh yeah, no, I didn't read it. No, of course not. I don't read dirt sheets, man. I'm a fan. I'm a real fan of professional wrestling.
Like Josh says, I'm a fan.
But I did love the promo. I thought, you know, it leaned too hard on diverting the attention away from the tension that's supposed to be between Triple H and the Undertaker. And
yeah, that was my problem with it.
That like, now is between HBK and the Undertaker. And I just thought in general, like now you kind of want to see HBK versus the Undertaker.
and I think this leads to, I mean, Shawn said it in the promo, he's going to be there. And I think this leads to Triple H beating the Undertaker.
I don't think that's going to happen.
I think he's going to beat the Undertaker. I think Shawn's going to help him. And I think that's going to be your Royal Rumble or Mania or Greatest Royal Rumble match. I think it's HBK coming out of retirement. He's the only guy that he would do it for. That's the only guy. You have two matches against them and then have them both ride up into the sunset. I don't see a lot of guys right now that are ready for a Shawn Michaels match other than like maybe AJ, who has his own things going on. Or, I mean, Daniel Bryan, who obviously has his own feud going on. And I mean, we're all interested in seeing how they're going to kind of do this feud and cascade it and then bring it back for Mania. I think that's where we're at with Bryan right now. And they should keep it that way. But it's just going to be really interesting to see where this happens in Australia. There's a level of intrigue in that match that I have now that I did not have a week ago after that promo.
So I don't think Shawn Michaels is going to come back. And I feel like every year it's the same conversation, and I feel like it's just not going to happen at this point. I think he's perfectly fine with the way his career ended and how he's moved on, and it's been a number of years since he's moved on, and I don't think I know he's around the business a lot now being, you know, a producer on NXT, but I don't think he's like really hankering to get back in the ring. I think there's nothing left to prove, even if it's one more match against, because one more match against Undertaker turns into two, and then and then two turns into another series of matches, especially if HBK actually beats the Undertaker. So I think I don't think he's going to necessarily come back, but I agree. There's a level of intrigue. They're putting it all into this program for, you know, the show. And it's just,
we got six weeks next week.
We got Triple H and Mick Foley. Where Triple H, I'm sure, is going to beat the shit out of Mick Foley again. So,
oh, he shouldn't do that. Foley just got a new hip. He can't do that. Foley's probably going to make himself bleed, though.
He's going to. Mick Foley is going to say something. Mick Foley is a very long promo. I don't know if people understand. Yeah, he rambles. He's a rambler. If you listen to any podcast he's been on, the man goes on a tangent and builds the tangent off another tangent. But I do think it's going to be a very riveting promo.
He's going to scream a lot. Next up, the tag team titles change hands. Dolph Ziggler and Drew McIntyre, the tag team champions, they destroyed the Revival backstage, which is why I think they're going to turn face to take their opportunity against the B team. This has been long overdue. I think even just as quickly as last week, we said, all right, we're done with the B team shit. Let's get to some other shit. And I mean, we called this, I guess, when they first came in, night after Mania, their shoe in for the tag titles. They finally did it. And I think this is possibly going to lead to a Rollins Dean versus Dolph Drew program at Hell in a Cell, which would, I mean, you give the Shield all the titles, that's money, baby.
I mean, yeah, quite honestly,
that's really money. How do you feel about just the decision to flip the titles on these two, and how long do you think they're going to have them?
I love it because I did not like the B team, quite honestly. But I think, how long do I think it's going to happen? I don't know I think as long as the Shield stay, they're going to probably have it, quite honestly. Yeah.
I think that they're going to have all the titles on Raw. And
so here's the thing. We had a debate this weekend on Twitter about everyone talking about the greatest factions in WWE history and people saying the Shield and stuff. You want to know how much the WWE loves the Shield? They're literally taking the same program from last year and cutting and pasting it to this year.
And it works.
Different people. And they're literally doing the exact, they're literally carrying on with what they're going to do. We're going to have Dean and Seth win the tag team championships. They're going to break up and do their own thing. The only difference is Roman is a champion. That's the only difference. But they're literally cutting and pasting. I mean, Braun Strowman is still in this feud, and he's still the bad guy. The only difference is it's not Cesaro and Sheamus anymore. It's fucking Drew and Dolph. So it's kind of like they're really just cutting it and doing the same thing they intended to do last year.
We're woke. We know what's going on. We know what's going on. We know what's going on, man. Like I'm okay with them redoing the story. It seems more organic this year than it did last year.
I agree.
And less like shoot in. It's actually more hot. It's I just think Roman with that title just makes everything a lot better, man. I'm just not even gonna lie. Like he got a different swag with the title.
And then I think just the refresh of Dean. I think maybe if Dean was still what he was last year, it wouldn't have felt as fresh or wouldn't have felt as actual serious as a threat. But I think with this new Dean and you know, in the year with Roman attempting to recapture whatever magic he had and Dean out, Seth Rollins has created just magic in his own right. Yeah. I really think more than last year, this is the year where everything is hitting on all cylinders and the stars seem to have aligned for the Shield.
Absolutely.
Except at the end of Raw.
Yeah, and we're going to get right to that. We had a Braun Strowman, Finn Balor main event match that closed off Raw. Of course, Finn Balor loses that match because you're just not allowed to beat Braun Strowman in any capacity, and your name is Finn Balor. We're not even talking about the biggest crux of the storylines of that night. Also, Titus Worldwide broke up.
Titus Worldwide broke up.
I guess that happened. Whatever.
Alexa Bliss learned an armbar.
Resets on resets. Meelz, you're talking about this ain't a big reset. This is a big reset for that.
Bobby Roode and Chad Gable
tag team. This felt like a night after Mania.
Yeah, I can
almost
see that.
Almost.
Except no one got called up, but I can.
Yeah, except nobody got called up. The Shield got arrested in the beginning of the night for inciting a riot and property damage or something like that.
On a wrestling show.
On Labor Day. They got out of jail. They were arraigned, which means that a judge saw them. Got out.
Returned. At 9:30 p.m., a judge saw them.
Got out. Got back to the arena by 11 o'clock.
11 o'clock.
Stole one of the cars, which who knows how they did that.
I don't know, but the judge will probably have to see them again after that.
Proceeded to get out the cars, and then out of nowhere, Kevin Owens and Drew Gulak started whipping their ass.
Well, good for Drew Gulak, man. Come on. MVP of the week. If I have to start a new MVP column, it's Drew Gulak for getting his time on Monday Night Raw. They said clear the locker rooms. I don't think they meant the 205 Live guys, but he came anyway.
He was there. Drew Gulak said, "You don't run nothing."
The man was slapping around Roman. I was like, oh, you know
what? We will never. You know what we need to see? We need to see the Shield. Remember that time on SmackDown when they showed up and beat up everybody on the roster? They need to go to 205 Live.
And oh no, that seems like bullying. That is bullying.
And find Drew Gulak and Jack Gallagher and be like, oh, you thought we forgot about you? Like Blade did on Blade 2. And then, like, proceed to whip Drew Gulak's ass.
Jack Gallagher was there?
No, I mean, like, that's who Drew Gulak hangs out with on 205. Yeah. That's his crew. That's his crew. Jack?
That was a dream show, man. Come on.
The whole heel side, and a lot of people have a bunch of questions about this. Okay, number one, Kevin Owens hates the Shield, okay? He hates the Shield, and Baron Corbin told him to do it.
I see where they're coming. Well, yes, Baron Corbin likely told them to do it, but I see where they're coming from, you know, helping out a man who literally threw you off a cage a month ago and also, like, destroyed all of your...
But who does he hate more? I mean, Roman...
I would hate Braun more, but he probably does hate Roman a significant amount.
He hates Seth a lot because Seth tried to take the Universal title from him.
Beat him last week and made him quit, right?
Yeah, he hates Dean Ambrose for fucking sure, because Dean Ambrose was like, they had like a last man standing match. Remember that? They hated each other about 2.5 years ago. So it all makes sense. The level of hate is probably threefold to Braun, whatever. sure. work with us here. Okay. There is some precedence to why he wouldn't just help out the Shield and he wouldn't just not be out there, you know? So they beat the shit out of the Shield, threw Seth Rollins into a car. The glass broke and his arms cut bloody. People were giving him finishers on the ramp. Everyone had five finishers.
That was awesome.
They was beating their ass, and the show ends with the Shield defeated. I don't know if you can write a more thoughtful hope segment than the Shield versus the whole roster, because that's what we want to see.
I mean, you talk about a Shield number one faction in WWE history. That ass whooping is coming, and everyone will cheer accordingly.
Yes.
So I feel like, you know, it is... We're building up to something. We're making the Shield special again, which, I mean, they're
already special, yeah.
But we're making them more special again.
And I think it leaves a level of intrigue for the Hell in a Cell match, because what if the roster clears out to help Braun win then? What happens then? And I really like the idea that the heels hate the Shield, because the Shield, they're faces, but they're asshole faces. They're asshole baby faces. They're bullies, essentially.
Yeah.
Love that idea. Love that idea. But that was Raw. Anything else on Raw?
Nah. Oh, Lita versus Mickie James is happening at Evolution.
Great. I mean, you got somebody that's going to take the fall and somebody that needs somebody that they're familiar with to have a match. I don't think that you want to put Lita against Asuka, because they're just not familiar with each other, and Asuka will knock her into 2004.
Yeah. On accident. Need that type of problems. Yeah.
You don't need that. No, not at all. Not at all. Let's move on to SmackDown, which is... they really book the shit out of SmackDown every week. They do a great job.
It's a great job every week. I don't even mind the people who are not actually featured every week on the show. Like, you know, Shinsuke Nakamura wasn't there this week. What happened?
Second week in a row, he wasn't there.
I don't believe Jeff Hardy and Randy Orton both got video packages but didn't make appearances. Because we're getting towards this Hell in a Cell and we're making everything hot, quite honestly.
Yeah.
And we've got three very scorching hot feuds. And that is Charlotte versus Becky, and that is the mixed tag match, and that is AJ versus Joe.
I argue and say that the three top feuds on SmackDown are, to me right now, bigger than the three top feuds on Raw right now. And that's even with the Shield. I mean, there's to me more investment in those three.
Yeah, there's way more personal hatred. There's more vitriol. There's more, like, there's hate between everything that's happened in this match. These aren't just stories that have been built up over the last, like, you know, 3 weeks, where they have Braun Strowman turn 1 week just to make an end to a means of how they reached the Hell in a Cell. They're just not doing that. Yeah. These are programs, The Miz and Daniel Bryan. You're talking about Becky and Charlotte. You're talking about Joe and AJ. These programs have been going on for months, and they're finally coming to a head, and it's going to be, quite honest, just awesome.
Yeah, and first off, I mean, kudos to whoever wrote the through line of this episode being Brian and Brie versus all the couples. I think that you have Zelina Vega and Andrade Almas, who, I mean, began the show and ended the show, in a great position here. I think you put Almas against, like, the two top guys on the show, and he essentially looks good. I mean, they had another match. Brian and Almas had another match this week, and I thought it was better than last week's match.
I thought so as well. And I thought just the interaction between everything and how everything, you know, it's just really good. Like, it's really good. Like, the Andrade Bryan match is really good. The interaction between Zelina and Brie, and then Zelina coming back at the end of the show is like, nah, fuck that. We're not taking this. And then we're just coming back to attack Brie once again. And then, you know, getting her comeuppance in that same segment. We got the R-Truth and Carmella payoff,
which was tremendous.
It's great. Are they really doing? Are we really turning Carmella face?
Well, this is, you said the decarmelization.
The decarmelization, man. I knew it was coming. I said once we get the title off of her, I feel like people will grow or appreciate her a little bit more.
I already, as soon as, and the thing is, whoever wrote that segment, they had, and they did it smartly, because it was really subtle, because Maryse has no reason to like Carmella. They're both heels, obviously, but they don't have a reason to like each other, because Maryse is who she is. Right. She called her Staten Island trash. And of course, Carmella, with her ego, she could easily turn into, like, tweener face, because she's going against someone who the crowd hates more than they hate her.
And so the difference between her face run when she initially was called up on SmackDown and just this, if this, you know, imminent face run, if she eventually goes that sort of route, is now that we have like at least 2.5 years of character built in. We have 2.5 years. We know exactly who she is. We know exactly where she's from. We know exactly what she is about. And now let's take that to the other side and let's build a new, you know, likable character off of it. She has the character development that you want to invest in, that you need as a face on the roster.
Absolutely. And I think you pair with R-Truth, there's really nowhere she could go but a face. And that's someone who has cash built up with the fans, where he won't look like a complete goof by being teamed up with her, and she can't really goof him out. You know, they'll bounce off each other in a comedy way. And I think that's a more organic combination than her and Ellsworth. I think, yes. I think there's a lot of ways you can go with those two as a really cool mixed tag crew. SmackDown brings a very youthful and cool type of, I want to say feeling to the proceedings here, where it's like you have couples working together. And I know you've always talked about, you didn't like how people on wrestling shows, they don't talk to the women. And now, like, you have people on SmackDown who talk to the women, and, you know, Paige is kind of like, you know, she's a woman GM. She talks to everybody, you know? And I think that's just really just one of the strong points of SmackDown every single week. But speaking of Asuka, I think we spoke about her a little bit earlier, but she returned and she was really, really over. I was very surprised at how over she was when she showed up to help Naomi.
I feel like it was like Stone Cold Asuka came back. Like, it was, everyone was ready for heads to roll and people to be kicked. And like, I generally, I love Asuka. Just love
fucking Asuka. We're big Asuka marks. And this is leading to a match at the Super Showdown event in Melbourne, Australia, where the Iconics will go back to their home country to face Naomi and Asuka. And I think there are two things that are going to happen in the next couple of weeks. So prepare yourself for this first one. Asuka's probably going to take an L. Okay, so just prepare yourself, guys. Like, it's going to happen. And two, I think she's going to turn heel.
I think just her turning heel in general. You know what? I'm down for it, considering I just feel like she's done everything she has as a face. And I think Asuka is just like a one-of-a-kind talent where even as a heel, it's work. Like, on NXT, she kind of like floated between both depending on the opponent. And she's made it work thus far. I don't know if it'll be great for Charlotte in this sort of like, the world, me against the world type of thing, where it's just like a lot of things going towards her way. But I think, you know, it'll be a nice little experience if Asuka eventually turns heel. But I just love her back on SmackDown, just in general. I think they're doing a lot of great things with the women on SmackDown, quite honestly.
And if you think of like what the heel turn did for Nakamura, I mean, Asuka was a perfect kind of cocky shit face heel in NXT, and I would love to see that for a longer amount of time, because she wasn't really healed that long before she left to go to the main roster. But speaking of heels and faces and alignments, WWE did an about face on Becky and Charlotte this week. I think that we have all seen the change in direction that they've had in regards to this program. Now it is basically both sides have a point. And, you know, it's up to the fans to decide who they want to cheer for. And resoundingly on Tuesday, they cheered for Becky.
I think they should get Charlotte out of this program as soon as possible.
Yes, I do. I really think
if they want to. Quite honestly, the longer this thing goes, the more terrible of a person she looks. And I think, quite honestly, I know there's probably a long term feud in store for this. And you know what? I think there is definitely a way to turn, you know, Becky against the people and have the people not want to cheer Becky.
I think that's what they want to do, but I don't think the people will accept that at all. She's completely gone back on the whole fans thing that they did the 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. I just think it's interesting where they want to go with it, but I do think that if this is the way they want to go, they might as well just take Becky or just move Charlotte away from the feud if you want to salvage anything moving into the WrestleMania main event.
And you want to give Charlotte something to do. They've already announced that they're going to face each other at Hell in a Cell and at Super Showdown, which I think is like, you should have did that after the Hell in a Cell, but you got to sell tickets to the show. So I get it. But I think this gives Charlotte something to do for like 3 months for sure. I'm not sure where they slide it into next, but I really
probably
think
a ladder match at TLC or something,
which would be cool. And I think, I mean, essentially in the end, you give Becky the belt and you let her run with the belt, and you have a tweener at the top. You have a heel Asuka at the, you know, there as well. And you can still keep Charlotte face. Don't turn Charlotte heel.
Right.
Just make it so, cause I mean, you still want to set up, if I'm presuming they want to set up the Ronda match next year. So you keep Charlotte where she is, but just kind of change the alignments a little bit and give her something else. But the thing is, I don't think they're going to cheer her over Asuka either if they decide to do that in the fall.
It'll be interesting to see what they do.
It's going to be interesting. But how'd you feel about the promo they did, the side-by-side promo?
You know what? I thought it was in the good use of time for the amount of time they're doing this. I don't think they want to do too much because – God, look at the reaction last week. I don't think that's what they intended to happen. But I think they knew it was going to happen. Like, I don't think they're stupid. Like, yeah. I think they hear the people, whether they listen to us or not, they hear the people and know how they're going to react. I don't think they're stupid at all. Like, no, we're just going to stubbornly, like, they know what's happening out there. Sometimes they just choose to ignore it. Sometimes they choose to accept it. I think with this program, it's a little bit of both.
Yeah.
But I think it's generally... It was a good couple minutes. I think, you know,
Becky saying "screw you" is a soundbite for the ages.
It's a,
like the "you bitch" was great. The "screw you" is even better. I think "you bitch."
I think this was great for soundbites for the like promo.
Oh, it's great for soundbites.
The video promo.
Great for sound bites for the A show as well. I really want to use them in some way. But lastly on SmackDown, how are you feeling about this AJ Styles Samoa Joe program? I don't know why AJ just hasn't gotten the gun and killed them.
Because AJ's an idiot. That's how it kind of feels like. Feels like he's a little bit too late on everything, and he's just kind of, you know, they got in a little bit of a physical altercation at this point, but it was nothing that, you know, was completely definitive in terms of, you know, Joe still got away, you know, I wouldn't say unscathed, but he was able to escape. And AJ
Joe got Styles, the mental advantage. Joe got the mental advantage over
100%. And I think that's what they're sort of plotting here. I don't know what they're going to go for, but I think this feud in general has heated up way more than it did last month, where last month it just kind of seemed like Joe was talking out of his ass for nowhere. And now a lot of things seem to have context with as the weeks continue to go by, and just the program is better.
Yeah. He seemed like contender of the month last month. And now it seems like he has an actual shot of actually winning the belt. I really like this better than the Nakamura program, because it delved into things with AJ's family. And those are things that Nakamura can't hit perfectly, because not just the language barrier, but because he just wasn't that type of character, and that's not the type of heel he is. Joe is completely with the bullshit, and I'm cool, and I really like what they've had him do. Just fucking with his family and his daughter. I personally would have loved for him to show up at the Styles residence and help his kids with their homework.
Yeah, I thought that was going to happen. Then it didn't happen. I guess they didn't want to film that.
AJ said, don't come to my fucking house.
But I do like the feud. I do like the feud and where it's going. I'm interested to see how this match goes now, especially considering it's, you know, it's not the Hell in a Cell match.
Yeah, it didn't need to be. I don't think it's a no DQ match. A no DQ match would be way more exciting to me. I think we've seen these guys in straight wrestling matches a lot, and I think a cool no DQ match would be cool. And that was it for SmackDown. Is there anything else you want to talk about in this week in wrestling, Meelz?
Not really. I think we got a lot of back and forth. I mean, it was a list that we didn't make, but I think there's a lot of back and forth regarding that greatest factions ever list that, you know, WWE released on their Instagram.
Let's do greatest factions next week. Let's do our greatest factions next week.
Quite honestly, you know what? We can do that. I don't think they're going to be too... For me, there isn't much change from what there is there, but...
We could do everything, though. We could do everything.
Oh, like in the biz?
Yeah, just in the business. We could do everything. Not just WWE. Hmm. Not just WWE.
You know what?
I like to get the people arguing. I like to get the people arguing, Meelz.
Listen, they argued. I got a lot of... We're the nation of domination. How come the ministry's not here? And I'm just like, bro. The
fucking ministry, bro.
I got the ministry, bro. The ministry.
The ministry. Do people realize the ministry wasn't like really together for that long?
I learned about the corporate ministry. And I'm like, bro, they were there for 5 months max.
Yeah. Like they weren't there that long.
Yeah. They were like, I got the corporation. Where's the corporation? And I was like, the corporation. It was like at some point they had, you know, Big Show, The Rock, and Triple H in them. I was like, bro, no.
But they weren't like dominant. They were
no, nor were they you know, a faction that has had any sort of cultural relevance on professional wrestling. They were a faction that was formed of the time. They were an end to a mean, and that mean was Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yes, absolutely. And getting squashed by him at all times.
Right. So that's essentially what it was. They wanted Austin to fight like 50 guys before he got to the champion or Vince McMahon. And that's essentially what the corporation was, or even the corporate ministry, quite honestly.
Well, you know what? If you want us to do our greatest factions, let us know. Hit us up on Twitter at RNC Radio Live and at OG Johnny 5 and at Meelz TV. And next week, we can see if we can squeeze that in. But as far as this week on RNC, we have The Lookout, which just came out this week, featuring my good friend Pafifi talking about the Majin Buu saga with Meelz and Jeff. How was that experience with Pafifi? He was so nervous.
That was fun. I didn't sense nervousness from him. It was just kind of because you just said, yo, bro, let's have this conversation about it. You want to talk about it? Let's talk about it. Like to me, people doing The Lookout becomes more of a, I wouldn't say like therapy, but you kind of get this nerddom off your chest that you would probably never speak about anywhere else at any point of time of your day. Like you would never have a full hour conversation about Dragon Ball and how stupid it was or how smart it was or anything. So that's kind of how I feel. Like I feel like for an hour of your day when you listen to The Lookout, you dive a little bit into your nerddom and then you go back into your normal life and try to figure that out.
So we got that this week. We had two belts that was talking about the horniest summer ever.
We both talk about the horniest summer ever. We talked about that Eminem album. We talked about a lot of things just via the summer. So, yeah, check out the new episode of Two Belts this week.
We'll, of course, have the A Show, and we have the Perfect Play. And we just announced that RSPN. Shout out
shout out to Huey, my guy.
Oh, shout out to Huey. The Perfect Play. He got engaged.
That's beautiful.
Shout out to him, but if he loses this fantasy football league, he has to call the wedding off.
God, is that the stipulation?
That is per Josh Pease. If he loses it, he has to call the wedding off. So that's
I love it. It's more professional wrestling than Josh Pease would like to probably admit.
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But yeah, it is. That's definitely going down the Perfect Play this week. He hasn't told me who's on the show. He never tells me until like the day before he asked me to upload it. But we also have RSPN is coming back. We just put out the teaser for that. So our boys, Mark and Jeff, are coming back for yet another season, a full season. Season 2 of RSPN is coming on RNC Radio Network. And just stay tuned for everything else. Check us out on SoundCloud, iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play. I think I got them all, didn't I?
Yeah.
Yeah, all of those. And we will be back next week with the latest and greatest in pro wrestling. So until next time, I'm Justin from Meelz. Peace out.
Happy Rusev Day.